Welcome to worship. We're glad you're here. If you want to sign in attendance pad, you're welcome to do that and update any information we might have. Go ahead and pause and get ready. Al's bringing us our message tonight. It's always very exciting when that happens. And we'll go ahead and pause for a moment of prayer. Let's pray. Lord God, we are grateful for tonight. We are so happy that you brought us here to have this wonderful fellowship over food. And now we feast on your word and on the presence of our brothers and sisters in Christ. We do ask for your healing on Jude and all those that are out sick and suffering and coughing and sneezing. Lord, that although you bring us this wonderful natural world, we also need your help to get over all the seasonal changes. And we are grateful that we have this wonderful time to be together. We ask now that your spirit block away all obstacles to our encountering you tonight. And let your spirit just overcome all of us as we are transformed by this encounter through music and proclamation of your word, of you, our Lord Jesus. We pray this in the name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen.
Stand up, please. Love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my my cross, you lay down your life. done for me.
Yes, I do. I do need that. How is everybody? If you don't know, my name is Al, and my wife is not here. I feel like Linus without my security blanket, so if you can keep her in your prayers. We moved this last weekend, and while I was moving, it just something just hit me. It's like an epiphany, this profound thought, is that you never know how much stuff you have until you move. I mean, I don't know if anyone's ever thought about that. I don't know if you ever use that, then you can. Actually, Kayla said that this weekend, and I'm trying to steal it, and I think it was pretty obvious. But thank you for everyone that helped us. It's a really interesting thing. It's an intimate thing because everyone sees your dirt and your stains and all that stuff. But it's also a great expression of love, so thank you for that. I'm going to talk tonight about my personal relationship with God. And I've always hated cliches. I was a rebel in college. I rebelled against everything you possibly can imagine. An example is that I used to buy my clothes at a thrift store because I refused for Madison Avenue to define me by some shirt they told me to buy. I'd rather be defined by that shirt that a homeless man wore 3 years ago and the smell. I'd rather be defined by that than defined by some commercial. So I rebelled against a lot of different things, and something happened. I got old. And this is for the young people. You need to hear this. Every single cliche is true. Every single one is true. The truest is that that's why they call them cliches, because they're all true. My favorite one right now is that my mom, when I was in my 20s, she sat me down. She said, you know what? You know what they say, the older you get, the smarter mom gets. And I looked at her and said, dear sweet woman, that is not going to happen with us. All right? I am always going to be intellectually here. I will never say that to you. And I got old. And I realized a lot of the obstacles I went through, if I listened to my mom, I never would have been in those obstacles. So you know what? In the last year and a half, I call her every single Sunday. I talk to her about everything. I ask her advice about everything, how to fold my clothes, how to deal with hangnails. I ask her everything. She's not God, but I feel like she's the voice of Elijah to me. She's like E.F. Hutton. When she talks, I listen. But the other cliche that's really come true for me is this personal relationship with God. And I always thought, you know, my entire life that when people talked about this, they were trying to justify kind of a powerless, intangible God in their lives. You know, you go from Genesis to Revelations, and there's supernatural stuff happening all the time. And so when agnostics and atheists come up and talk about it, well, you know, how do you know your God is real? Well, it's because of my personal relationship. And I just always thought that was a cop-out. Well, I have discovered a personal relationship with God, and it is that personal relationship for me that proves he exists, and proof that he takes pleasure in me, and that he delights in me. Micah, why don't you go ahead and read Psalms 103. By the way, my teammate over there, Micah, I am the brains, he is the brawn. Applause.
Right.
Now, I've read that chapter a lot. I've heard it about it a lot. And there's very generic terms, these ethereal terms. And I'm going to tell a story about how that has individualized in my life, how it's become personal. I have this agape box since Emmaus. And in the last year and a half, when God does something amazing in my life, I take a memento from that event and I put it in this box, or even some things or pictures in my house or standing somewhere as decoration. But I have this agape box, and there are about 60 items in this agape box. One of the things that's in the agape box is that a year and a half ago, the Father's Day before, we had a Father's Day, and usually, you know, fathers don't get a whole lot of credit. The mom goes out, buys a gift, the kids sign the card. They don't even know what the gift is until the dad actually opens it. But in this occasion, my son just turned 20, had a jobby job, and he's like, you know what? I'm going to go and I'm going to buy my dad gifts with my own money. So he went and he bought me 6 Father's Day gifts. And he created a scavenger hunt, and he had these riddles that he put on these note cards. This is also in my agape box. And I had to go around the house to find these gifts. This was the best Father's Day I've ever had. What I didn't know is that somehow that my son tapped into some prophetic gift, because in each one of these gifts, God was telling me something that he was going to do in my life in the next year. There's something, every single one of these gifts represented something prophetic that God did in my life. And I don't have time to talk about all those things, but I do want to talk about one. And that's this picture that he got me. And in the picture, it talks about second chances. It talks about a family that does hugs, a family that is real, a family that is authentic. And as you know, that we're all broken people, we're all sinful, and the people that we hurt most are our family members. And God provided many opportunities for me to walk out some redemptive arcs for my family. I'm going to tell you about one that's with my youngest son, Seth. When I was a basketball player in college and in high school, and I was trained by this man called Don Meyer, he was considered the godfather of basketball. And probably people don't know who he is, but he was the all-time winningest coach. He literally wrote the book on shooting, on help side defense, on triple threat, all types of things. All the big-time coaches knew who he was. And this is who I was trained under. And so one of the things I had to do during the summer is that I had to coach kids. And I did this for 8 years, and it was a little bit of money, but it seemed like it was a waste of time. And this is in my 20s, and I'm coaching kids every single summer. And so I go on 20 years later, I have this beautiful young child at 5 years old. We moved down here from Nashville to Jacksonville. My wife immediately gets a job. I was not able to find one yet, so at that point in time, I became the world's ugliest housewife. I had to take the kids to school, I had to cook, I had to do the cleaning while I was looking for a job. And so I got to spend an hour in the morning when I dropped Seth off with my oldest son, Jacob, and then I had to spend another hour with my youngest son while we were waiting for Jacob to come out of school. All my 5-year-old Seth wanted to do was train. And that's what we did. All 8 years of experience teaching, I poured into Seth at 5 years old. I trained him, spent thousands of hours training him up to 7th grade. I was his first coach. I never missed a game, ever. So when 7th grade came along, it became more serious. He did summer AU, summer travel basketball, and I did that. And my parents never came to a game. They never had to pay a dime. That's what I thought it was going to be like. I got the schedule. There were 12 games during that summer. And I'm like, there's no way you're going to go to all these. You're going to go to 4 or 5. At the same time, we were dealing with some difficult things in our lives. I was dealing with my own narcissism, my own sins, my own shame. And all of a sudden, this AU season started. And he went to every single tournament. Every single weekend, he was gone. And so my wife and I went to the last tournament. It was in Orlando. It was a national tournament. And it became obvious to me that for every single one of his teammates, their dads and their moms had attended every single tournament. Every single tournament. And I'm like, who are these super dads that got jobs that they can take Fridays off and Mondays off and spend $6,000 flying and driving all over the South? These are super dads, and some of their kids weren't that good. But Seth was 12, and he didn't see them as super dads. He saw them as dads. And that brought incredible disappointment to him about who I was. It was his first comparison, and that brought me shame. And so I've spent decades dealing with shame, of medicating, of deflecting, of trying to avoid, and it always makes the situation worse. There was something different, though, that happened with me when this brokenness had been presented to me. Three months later, I went to Emmaus. And I'd like to tell you about it, a little bit about it. One of the things I learned in Emmaus is that they said you can't talk about it. And this has kind of got me in trouble. I found out you can talk a little bit about it. But this kind of got me in trouble. When I finished my walk, I was really proud. I wore this necklace everywhere. I slept in it. I showered in it. I wouldn't take it off. The only issue is when I went to Winn-Dixie, the grocery store, men kept coming up to me and asking me where groceries were. A guy would come up to me asking where bread was, and another guy would come up. You know, every single week, some guy was asking me where groceries were, and I'm like, do I look like I have a Winn-Dixie smock on? And so finally I asked the cashier, I was like, why do you guys keep coming up to me asking me where groceries are? You know, is there someone here that looks like me? And she pointed my necklace, so I think it's the necklace you're wearing. I'm like, oh, that's not what this means. This means something else. And she asked, what does it mean? And I sighed and I said, I can't talk about it. So you can't talk about it a little. So Emmaus, the walk to Emmaus, how many people have been to Emmaus? Everyone knows. The walk to Emmaus is that it comes from two disciples basically walking to Emmaus, and this is after Jesus had died and raised and was risen from the dead. And they were just talking, and some stranger came along beside them and started telling them through the scriptures what actually was occurring, and all of a sudden their eyes were open. And so that is what happened to me. That's how I can explain this at Emmaus, is that my eyes were open. I have been a Christian for 40 years, and I don't think I was born again until I got to that experience. And so, you know, one of the things that happened is I felt the Spirit ask me to write down every single way that I felt God disappointed me, right? And so I wrote down all those things, the ways that I felt God disappointed me. He showed me five things. One, he showed me that he provided opportunities for me to avoid these pitfalls, to avoid these trials, and because of my own lack of character, because of my own sinful nature, that I made the wrong decision. It wasn't the wrong decision in that situation. It was the 100 wrong decisions that I had made before where it made me incapable of making the right decision. The second thing he showed me was that this thing called prevenient grace. Well, first of all, justified grace, that he actually protected me from consequences of some of the things that I had done. This is the third thing showed me was prevenient grace, which is my favorite thing, is that he prepared the path of escape, the path of salvation, the path of redemption before the sin actually took place. My whole life I've been hearing, you know, that God hates sin, which he does, and if he sins, he doesn't want to have anything to do with you. In these examples that he showed me, he knew that I was going to sin. He knew that I was going to make the wrong decision. And yet before the actual sin, he was already planning to rescue me. He was already planning to redeem me. The fourth thing he showed me was redemptive grace. And the fact that he can take these situations, the consequences of this brokenness, he can turn it around and use it to bless me. And the fifth thing he showed me was glorified grace, that I was still on the path to accomplish something through the grace of Jesus Christ because of the sacrifice, as if I'd never sinned. At this point, my eyes were open, and I absolutely began to fall in love with God. I'm going to tell you a secret. This is going to be, you know, my wife's going to be watching this later, and she's going to say this is really arrogant, and I'm hyperbolizing, all right? This is a joke. Not a joke, but I'm hyperbolizing. This is the greatest thing you ever heard in your life, all right? I'm about to tell you the greatest thing that you'll ever hear in your life. You know the secret to righteousness, the secret to holiness, the secret to pleasing God, the secret to getting everything we possibly could want. The secret I'm about to tell you right now is to fall in love with God. Take pleasure in him. The Bible says that if we know how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, the love of God in Christ, then we will be filled to the fullness of his measure. The Bible says there's only one way to actually fall in love with God, is to know that your sins are forgiven. It's incredibly powerful, powerful feeling. Incredibly powerful state of being to know someone intimately knows who you are. He knows the vulnerabilities. He knows the weaknesses of who you are. Who knows the mistakes, the possibilities, the potential of your capacity to do evil and still to love you and believe in you anyway. There's another letter that I got from my, it's in my agape box, and it was a letter sent from my oldest son, Jacob, who, again, I say has got some type of prophetic gift. I don't remember all the letters that I got, but I do remember this one, and when I read it, I cried and cried and I cried, if I can find it here. No, I got it. I would never lose it. So he thinks I lose everything, so... So if you can imagine, after this incredible weekend that I read this, right before I was about to leave, it's from my oldest son. I'm going to try to keep my eyes dry up here. I'm so proud of everything we have accomplished and what we still have yet to overcome. I love you so much, Dad. We are here through it all to the very end, living with trust and values, making mistakes, and having people around that love you enough to forgive, knowing it's okay to fail, but it's never okay to give up. Having constant support and knowing that if you fall, you have family that will always be there. That's what it means to be an Allen, and I am proud of it. I was created to be loved that way. I was created to be loved that way. You were created to be loved that way. God wants to love us that way. And so when I discovered that, it was easy to repent. I was repenting all over the place. I was asking forgiveness all over the place. It was easy to, because I knew that God was there to redeem the brokenness in my life. And so it was easy for me to go to my son and to repent about his summer in basketball and to try to find a path to redemption. And so I sat down with him. We talked about the upcoming season. And we created a PowerPoint for the upcoming eighth grade season. And this is the story of it.
Dear LA Fitness, my name is Al Allen. The members of my family are the jewels in my crown. My beautiful wife, Jude, gave me the blessing of two boys, Jacob, 21, and Seth, 14. Since he could barely walk, Seth loved basketball. Even at the age of 5, he begged me to teach him, and I did, passing all I learned from my college career. My Little League provided highlights and memories. When Seth became an 8th grader, the competition became more serious. I asked him what he wanted to accomplish his last season of middle school, and he said, Dad, I want to be one of the best players ever to play at my school. I believed he possessed the ability to attain that ambition. So I created a PowerPoint presentation for Seth. The first slide simply consisted of 10 words. The next slide listed the goals that he would need to achieve in every game he played in the upcoming season. Best shooter, best ball handler, most athletic player, and etc. The next slide covered the 11 strategies it would take to ascertain those goals. And the next 11 slides itemized 5 to 11 objectives to accomplish those strategies. The season started in 3 months, and the work we committed to seemed daunting. Seth can complete a few of those objectives when he woke up and finished his homework, but for most of his training, only one place contained everything we needed to accomplish his vision, LA Fitness. With all this in mind, we began our training. LA Fitness became our second home. We trained there 3 to 4 times a week, sometimes arriving at 6 in the morning so we could practice in the gym by ourselves. Everything we needed, LA Fitness accommodated. Seth worked on getting stronger, faster, and quicker. We performed numerous shooting and ball handling drills. I would play him one-on-one, mentoring him in what he just learned. Then he would lift weights and complete a plyometrics workout, jumping over boxes in between ropes. Once a week, we would play in a pickup game at LA Fitness, applying what he learned during the week. We did this every week for 3 months. A week before the season began, we played our last pickup game against college players and adults. One of the college players could not believe how well Seth shot during warm-ups. I told him, "You haven't seen anything yet." Our team happened to win that game with Seth and I scoring all of our team's points. Of course, it didn't matter that he scored 24 of those points and I only scored 6. Our team won. Afterwards, I told him, "You play this season like you played in that last game. You will become a legend at your school and they will talk about you for years to come. You are ready." And ready he was. He led his team in scoring, rebounding, assists, blocks, and steals. He played every position on the floor. His dexterity and skills made him at times unstoppable. His team finished the season tied for first place in their division. He made the all-conference team. But we both knew, even after his astonishing season, to accomplish his mission, his team would need to win the city championship. To succeed, his team would need to win 5 games in a row against the best teams in the city. Before the first game that week, I told him that he may need to make game-winning shots to advance. I asked him about his nerves. He said confidently, "Dad, this is what we train for." As if I prophesied it, he dominated and made incredible plays in the last moments to win every game, including the city championship. His team won it all as the tournament declared Seth the Seth School won the first city championship in school history. I think I can say my son accomplished his dream of becoming one of the greatest players ever at his middle school. That week produced one of the greatest memories for my family. Seth's team winning the championship took great coaches and teammates. It took his mom taking him to doctor's appointments for therapy after injuries during the season. It took multiple motivational speeches from his big brother Jacob. It took my mentorship. It even took his grandmother's prayers when shooting free throws in the last minute. But mostly, it took Seth's talent, hard work, and character. However, none of it would have been possible without LA Fitness. LA Fitness provided all the tools to assist Seth in fulfilling his potential as a middle school basketball player. Ironically, I cannot help but think of a million commercials where actors pretend a product caused an indispensable impact on their lives. But the Allens are not actors. LA Fitness did offer us an indispensable service to accomplish a dream of my son's. These videos and pictures are not manufactured. This story is not scripted. All of it happened. Most importantly, LA Fitness helped a father and son become even closer. By the way, LA Fitness helped me lose 35 pounds in the last year. While my wife thanks you for my weight loss, I won't thank you at this time for helping my boy. Seth accomplished one dream, but a lifetime of dreams light his path, and he is just getting started. High school basketball begins in September, so another several months of training lay before us. And again, I will say about Seth, you haven't seen anything yet. See you at 6 a.m. Sincerely, a proud dad of 2 boys and a proud member of LA Fitness.
And school history, and it was considered the greatest season by an individual player. And how it actually came about is that we were driving somewhere. I looked at my son and I said, "Man, that is a good-looking kid. He should be doing commercials or something." And I thought, "Well, I look just like him. I should be doing commercials. What commercials can we do?" And then we had this huge thing. So I made this kind of highlight video, and I gave it to the general manager because everyone was really asking about him, and it got submitted to the corporate office. But I have like 60 stories of this where these supernatural things where God has taken this thing that was broken and has brought redemption out of it. In this story, this one story, that there is justified grace in which God protected us from the consequences of the brokenness of our relationship from that summer before. There's prevenient grace there. 5 years ago, there was no LA Fitness. Does anyone believe that God loves me enough to build an LA Fitness just for me? 4 years ago, my mom decided to pay for that membership. She said God told her to pay for a family membership for LA Fitness. I didn't go for 2 years, and she kept paying for it. And so it was such a blessing. I talked to her a couple weeks ago. I was like, man, you're extremely obedient. What did God say to you to make you believe and pay for this every single month, even though I wasn't going? And she said, well, the Holy Spirit said to me, remember your athletic son? And she's like, yeah. He's getting a little fat, isn't he? And that's what inspired her to pay for that membership. But that's prevenient grace. God already planning a path of redemption for me. There's obviously the redemptive grace, the fact that we probably would not have been as motivated to be able to do the training we did to produce the type of season. And then there is glorified grace, the result as if I'd never sinned, that truly proves that Jesus Christ paid for every sin, that I sent this video to them. And I didn't write that headline. They wrote that headline. Father and Son Disciples Team. So I went from, in my brokenness, almost being the worst dad ever to being a super dad. Basketball is insignificant. Middle school basketball is insignificant. There are 500 city champions last year. There's only one father-son combination that actually got sponsored on a national website with that video going to every single member in the LA Fitness community. That is the grace of God. That is the redemptive grace of God. And so when I had Micah read Psalms 103 before, it was this generic scripture, right? It was this ethereal thing. But in that story that I just told you, did you not see as you're talking about Psalms 103, did you not see God forgiving me of my sins? Did you not see him redeeming a part of my life from the pit? Do you not see him crowning me with love and compassion and glory? Did you see him work his righteousness for me, that he made his ways known to me? Did you see his graciousness for me, abounding in love for me, that he did not treat me as my sins deserve in this story, that he removed my transgressions from me, that he treated me with the compassion of a father treating his son, that he gave me his love? And the last sentence is that praising the Lord with all your soul. From this story, you bet I did. I praised him with everything that I had. That is a personal testimony of my relationship with God that proves not only that he exists, but he passionately, passionately loves me and takes delight in me. Let's pray. Dear Father, I just thank you for this amazing, incredible church and just for this opportunity to be up here. I thank you for your heart that even before the beginning of time that you purposed us to be saved through your Son. And there's so many incredible elements of that. So there's so many things about that we probably are never going to know until heaven. But you began creation knowing that you're committed to giving us your greatest resource, the very thing that made heaven rich, your only begotten Son, that before you even said, let there be light, that you committed to giving everything you had to love us. I pray, Lord, that we discover that love. I pray that we have our eyes open and that we may be able to see how much you love us, that we may be filled to the fullness of your measure, and that we may fulfill every single dream and expectation, every single purpose, every single desire that you have of us. In your name we pray. Amen. Chases me.
felt no worth. You paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Yeah.
Join hands, your neighbor, receive this benediction. Lord God, we thank you for the hands that we clasp. We thank you for this place you've given us to worship. We thank you for the example of your love that is so undeniable, that is so all-encompassing. And we ask, Lord, that you give us the strength and the power and the guidance of your spirit that we may love others in the same way. Where all may know that in you they have that perfect, perfect heavenly parent. So we claim tonight in honor of you, our Lord Jesus, and we dedicate our lives once again to serving you. And until we meet again, may our paths be shed in your light. Just let everything we do, everyone we meet, know that we love you and that they are loved by you. We claim this in the name of our Lord Jesus as we go in peace. Amen.